Today's event, and on behalf of Torrent Pharma, on behalf of PG Bonanza webinar series, I welcome you all to this unique academic initiative which we have initiated with the support of Dr. Sudhakar Rao and Dr. Mukund. Today we have with us Dr. R. Krishna Kumar, to take the proceeding further, I just would like to brief few points. Being the host of the program, let us ensure that all the participants are muted. Currently we have kept everyone on mute so that if there are any queries, you can put it in the chat box. If you have any questions, please put there. We would like to have the discussions as Dr. Rao suggested. I welcome you all once again. And now I hand over to Dr. Mukund to take the proceedings further.
I'll waste not much time for introducing Krishna Kumar sir, who is already very popular and well known. He is one of the pioneer pediatric cardiologists of our country. And as a student, I always aspired to listen to his talks, and we used to learn a lot from his talks. Though he's known as a pediatric cardiologist, he's well versed not only in pediatric cardiology but also in arrhythmias, statistics, rest of the cardiology. And it was a pleasure to work with him for a short while, some time back. And I'm sure all of you will thoroughly enjoy today's session, and I request you to make the best use of next 1.5 hours to ask whatever questions you want. Over to you, Krishna Kumar sir.
Thank you, Mukund. So this is a good opportunity really to interact and discuss, and I had suggested a slightly changed format. I would give a bit of an introductory theoretical framework, and then I will request the four presenters to present their cases one by one, which we will then go through those cases and use those case examples to illustrate some of the concepts that I have brought out in my talk. So this will hopefully consume all the time, but if there is time to spare, I think there is a very important related issue to today's topic in terms of assessment of size of shunt. There's also the issue of operability. So if there is time, we can consider discussing at least some core concepts related to operability. So with this, I'll just begin quickly, and I think you can see my presentation slides. Can you?
Yes, sir.
Mukund, are you able to see my slides? Yeah. So I'm keeping it extremely simple, the initial part. I will start by asking the question, why? Why should we have I've used the word precise, but as precise as possible idea about shunt size. Why does it matter so much? I think the answer is pretty obvious. Everybody who takes care of children with congenital heart disease would like to take a decision based on the significance of the defect. So this is a very straightforward answer. It's a very important question to answer whether we need to intervene or not. All management decisions are based on how significant the defect is. Now, for the sake of definitions, we have basically a spectrum of shunts, which is insignificant to really clinically significant. And we human beings have made some, artificial sort of demarcations as to what is large, what is small, what is moderate. I don't think this has been very clearly classified anywhere. If you take anything for that matter, you take valve regurgitation severity, there is grade 1, 2, 3, but basically it is the whole concept is to try and convert a spectrum into 3 or 4 categories. Here also we are doing the same thing. We are converting a spectrum of possibilities into 3 categories. Now what are these categories and what are the basis of these categories? What is small? I think you'll all agree that small is something that has no discernible hemodynamic consequence. So the patient is clinically unaffected, and this has no impact whatsoever on the life, on the natural history, on anything. So this is a truly small shunt. What is large? Again, I don't think there is any confusion here. Large has got serious hemodynamic consequence. And it has major impact on the patient's presentation, it can threaten life, it can present with heart failure, host of problems. The real confusion arises in this moderate zone, because my moderate may not be the same as your moderate, and what my understanding of moderate may not be the same as somebody else's. So there is a lot of problem in this gray zone. It has some hemodynamic consequences, but again, it's very subtle at times. So here we have difficulty in making decisions. And this is true for anything, any hemodynamic lesion that we deal with. Nonetheless, I'll go through some of the guiding principles. Now, the one thing the students want to ask, sir, how many millimeters should we call it as small ASD? How many millimeters as small VSD? And we have all these classifications. VSD is large if it has got the same size as aortic annulus, if it is, you know, or two-thirds aortic annulus or half aortic annulus, and nobody really knows that answer. And it's important to understand that we shouldn't be searching for these numbers. We should understand the concept. And this is the framework I want you to remember with this slide. Because it doesn't have to be having a certain fixed diameter, because there are so many variables. So within this framework, we have to understand there are many considerations. When you want to assess shunt size, there are several considerations. And I'm going to go through these considerations one by one, because when you are confronted with a clinical situation, a challenge, and you have to give a decision, you need to take into account all these considerations. Age. So obviously, you know, a small VSD in a two-month-old baby, one-month-old baby, a large VSD will be something like, let's say, some VSD which is 5 or 6 millimeters in size, unrestricted in a tiny baby. But if this is in an 80-kilo adult, that 5 or 6 mm ASD VSD is of no significance. So age and weight is very important, but there is an additional factor, which is prematurity. If you have a preterm child, a duct which is 1 millimeter, 1.5 millimeters can produce problems potentially. 2 millimeters can be significant, and 2.5 millimeters could be serious. So clearly, a prematurity has a slightly different connotation, because their ability to tolerate volume overload is even worse. If you take a newborn, again, there is a evolving pulmonary vasculature. So a relatively large defect may not manifest as a significant shunt. A young infant will start manifesting, an older infant will have a different kind of presentation. Because of all this, the manifestations are going to be different in a child, in an adolescent, and in an adult. So this is a very important consideration, age and prematurity. Next, we come across pulmonary vascular resistance. And it's a related concept. If you have elevated pulmonary vascular resistance, it definitely interferes with your shunt assessment. And by and large, this is a problem only in large defects. But occasionally you have relatively small defects and elevated pulmonary vascular resistance. Then it becomes very challenging to really decide what is the significance of the defect. A good example would be a 10-year-old or a 15-year-old with a 12 or 15 millimeter ASD and PH. And it's not an uncommon situation to get that. How do you decide what is the importance of that shunt? So that's an important consideration. Comorbid conditions, anemia. So we recently had a patient who had a moderate size ASD and was significantly anemic, was looking much sicker than would usually, you know, you expect for that size of defect. And anemia can really cloud any hemodynamic condition. Respiratory infection can interfere with your shunt assessment. If there is significant respiratory infection, it can mask the shunt across the defect. Spinal deformity can produce respiratory compromise. Upper airway obstruction syndromes can markedly influence the way you assess these shunts. And very important is the early postoperative state. A shunt that is insignificant under normal circumstances, in postoperative state, it becomes significant. So normally a VSD, you would say a child, 2.5-3 mm VSD in an infant normally will not give trouble, but in the postoperative state suddenly becomes important, because the child's whole physiology has changed, the child is far more vulnerable. And a very good example is tetralogy. I don't know if you attended the last Sri Chitra presentation on a case with of tetralogy who went on to become very, very ill. This patient had a residual VST that was hemodynamically significant, but wasn't gigantic. It was a 6 mm VST. But that 6 mm VST will give absolute trouble in tetralogy because the whole physiology is different in that situation. The pulmonary valve is incompetent. So whatever goes into the pulmonary circulation falls back into the right ventricle. The right ventricle enlarges and fails very early. The patient has right heart failure. So the early postoperative state is a very different situation. And the rules that you have for usual shunt assessment do not apply to the early postoperative. Another good example is you have a post-op tetralogy with a large colatin. And the patient was actually perfectly fine preoperatively. No problems because of the collateral, but postoperatively, suddenly, this collateral starts to become extremely important. The patient floods, cannot extubate, and has hemoptysis, all has pulmonary, regional pulmonary edema. So this is again an example of how your comorbid conditions, your associated conditions can influence your shunt assessment. Associated lesions. So you often don't have congenital heart disease coming in isolation. Very interesting example is a combination of AST and a VST. An infant who has a 4 or 5 mm moderate looking VST is far sicker if there is a large associated AST. And that can compound your assessment that produces, you know, relatively large RARV or LALV is not very much enlarged. And that is a very important combination that you need to consider. So combination of shunts, AST with VST, associated mild RVOTO, which can be subtle, but if it is significant, it can have an impact on the associated shunt. LVOTO will exaggerate the shunt, coarctation will exaggerate, and even you may not have frank LVOTO, but you could have relatively small left-sided structures, and they would exaggerate the flow across a relatively moderate defect. So a 5 mm VST in the presence of posterior deviation of the coronal septum and mild LVOTO can be far more serious than a regular 5 mm VST. AST with MR is a very good example of an associated lesion that produces havoc. Now, we recently had a child who came from Calicut and was being admitted with just a diagnosis of AST. 1-year-old child in heart failure with AST and just not being getting better, all kinds of medication being given, but the child had a significant mitral regurgitation that wasn't evident when you did your echo sort of casually, because the jet was extremely unusual and totally wall hugging, going along the posterior mitral leaflet along into the left atrium. And that was greatly exaggerating the shunt, and the patient was sick. Now this patient had an ASD closure with mitral valve repair and the patient was fine. So this is very important to look at. Now, here is something that is not taught on a regular basis, and that is the sensitivity and specificity of the tools that we have. We all go through DM examinations and all the time try to confront examiners. And examiners also have been sticking to these age-old concepts for many, many years without even testing what we are doing on a day-to-day basis, whether there is scientific validity. So it's very important to recognize that and discuss understanding the sensitivity of your tools. Give you example, history. History, what is the specificity of recurrent respiratory tract infections in the likelihood of the patient having a sizable VST? Now here's an example I'll give you. A 5-6 month old child has a 4 mm VST and has recurrent episodes of respiratory. Now, I would say not 6 month old, let's say 2-year-old child. A 4 mm VST and recurrent respiratory tract infections. How can you put the two of them together? Now, unfortunately, we lay a lot of emphasis on and say that this is recurrent respiratory tract infection and it has to be associated with congenital heart disease. If you talk to any family living in Delhi, perhaps before the lockdown, there every urban child is now having frequent respiratory tract infections. Now to try and attribute that respiratory tract infections to congenital heart disease sometimes is very tricky. So the specificity of frequent respiratory infections in the context of identifying a significant shunt is limited. Unfortunately, this information is not widely talked about. As a result, a lot of emphasis is laid, and the PGs often go off track. They say, sir, but this is like they'll be presenting a tetralogy, and then just because the patient is having frequent respiratory infection, they'll change the diagnosis. That's unacceptable. So it's very important to actually stick to a very understand the specificity of these particular manifestations. That comes with clinical practice, judgment, spending time with patients. Second is physical exam. How specific is each of those physical signs that you have? And very important to recognize the most specific signs are the ones you're very sure about and that have a clear relationship to the hemodynamics. The loudness of the systolic murmur, the length of the systolic murmur, the presence of the apical diastolic murmur, that is hard data. If you have an apical mid-diastolic murmur that you're sure about in a child who has a large VS or who has a VST, you can be pretty certain that the VSD is hemodynamically significant. But if you don't have it, you can't rule out. So it's very important. And that's not been worked out. Nobody has figured out how important is MDM. What is the sensitivity and specificity of these of MDM in predicting a large shunt for a VST? Nobody knows that answer. We sort of presume it's very good sign. It's very important to recognize that. A hyperdynamic precordium and a prominent apex beat is very useful. It's very specific, but perhaps you may have an occasional child who has a significant shunt, but does not have that. Just the lie of the heart may be a little different. So you have to be aware of that possibility. Often when you put everything together, when you put the precordial palpation, the presence of a hyperdynamic precordium, the apex beat, the mid-diastolic murmur, the splitting of the second heart sound, and the symptoms, when you put it all together, you get great confidence as you move forward. But you have to recognize when you look at each symptom or sign in isolation, you have to know that they all have their limitations. ECG, actually ECG is least useful in this circumstances. I think Mukund will agree that ECG is a very poor indicator of atrial enlargement. The P wave can, if it is prominent, yes, it suggests atrial enlargement, more specifically for right atrium, less specifically for left atrium. But if it is not prominent, it in no means does it rule out significant atrial enlargement. So a P wave is not so useful. The Q wave in V5, V6 is an indicator of volume overload. Again, nobody knows how good it is as an indicator of volume overload. In my opinion, extremely insensitive. You can have significant LV enlargement and you still may not have Q waves in V5, V6. So important to recognize that. Chest X-ray is really useful, very useful in classifying physiology. So by and large, if your chest X-ray is normal, that tends to take away a hemodynamically significant shunt, especially if it is a post-tricuspid shunt like a VST or a PDA, it takes away that possibility. But chest X-ray, heart size is very useful. Lung vasculature have actually done a study where the sensitivity specificity of pulmonary plethora, signs of pulmonary plethora is 60 to 70%. So in 60 to 70% of instances, if you have evidence of increased pulmonary blood flow on chest X-ray, that is going to predict an increased QP. But there is no, again, there is limitation in that also. But the heart size is very useful to predict. Again, very important that it's not very useful in newborns. It's not very useful in preterms with PDA because it takes a while before the heart size can enlarge. So very important to recognize those circumstances where you can't apply the chest X-ray, post-operative state, you cannot apply it. So it's very important. Then comes echo. The big problem is we jump to echo. We jump to echo without doing a good history, physical exam, X-ray and ECG, and straight go to it and try to classify lesion severity. And we make big mistakes in that. Very important to go through all this, first four things, and then go to echo, because then you know what you're looking for and the added data gives a much better assessment of the patient's status. So very important to look at all four, and echo of course shows you in post-tricuspid, there is no problem because it tells you the PA pressures. It tells you whether the defect is restrictive or not. And that's one of the most important things that you need to figure out. That is far more important than actually trying to measure the size of the defect. The thing that happens very often and it becomes very difficult is in VSTs. And I'll come to that a little later, but let's say a moderate VSD you have, and there's a gradient of, let's say, a 70 across the VSD, or 55, 60 that's across the VSD. But the patient has a left atrial enlargement and left ventricular enlargement. This is likely to be hemodynamically significant. Now there, the decision-making problem happens, that you have to take a decision whether to close it or not. And often we make that decision based on visual assessment of LA, LV enlargement, which is wrong. If you take many, you know, active young people, you will find the LA, LV size not very different from that of small, these VSD patients. So it's very important to measure the LA, LV size, LV size in particular, and represent it in terms of Z-scores. So every pediatric measurement has to be indicated in terms of Z-scores. And if it is more than plus two standard deviations, a Z-score is essentially number of standard deviations. So plus two standard deviations more than what is recommended, what is expected for that age and weight, then you can say, okay, LV is truly enlarged. And then you can say, okay, perhaps this is hemodynamically significant. Again, go back to history, physical exam, X-ray, ECG, before you make a final decision. Cath has limitations when it comes to assessment of shunt size, little more than what you would imagine. It's okay to, it's perfectly accurate for QPQS ratios, but it doesn't help measure the flow volumes as well as you would think, because you assume oxygen consumption, and there are a lot of errors when you use oximetry. So Cath has some limitations. It's of course much better. It quantifies the severity of the shunt quite well. But again, you don't catheterize people for this anymore. Today, we don't do it. We actually depend on the first five things that I have listed. But the question I wanted to ask everybody in the audience, perhaps, and we can discuss that later, which is the gold standard of calculating the shunt size, the extent, the volume that is going across a VSD or the QP, the actual QP, the actual QS, and the actual QP-QS ratio. The gold standard is no longer cath. The gold standard is MRI. So if you have a good, robust MRI program, you can actually get a very accurate QP-QS assessment, and that should be your gold standard in today's times. So, of course, we don't do the last two tests. We hardly ever do it, but the first four, the first five tests, we have to integrate together and get this good concept of sensitivity, specificity, and integrate all these variables, and then you get a good idea. The other very important thing is our own biases. So I had showed you the initial paradigm where, you know, you have the classification of small, moderate, and large. Now, the thing is that, why do we have these biases? Because we have our biases for our threshold for intervention. This was not a problem when we could not close VSD in the cath lab. When we could not close VSD in the cath lab, we would wait on even moderate VSDs for a long time and say it's not required, patient is doing well. But suddenly now we have a tool and we are finding reasons to close these small defects. There is no question. You would need to close a defect if it is symptom is attributable to the lesion. You have unequivocal clinical signs and chest X-ray and echo findings that corroborate with this. It is not indicated if there are no symptoms, there is no clinical evidence of a significant shunt, normal chest X-ray, X-ray, echo shows no clear hemodynamic effects. Under these circumstances, it's fair to say no lesion really needs to be closed. Perhaps some exceptions for PDA to prevent endocarditis, maybe, not sure, but certainly not indicated for VSD. There is this gray zone that is subjected to a variety of biases, depending on your capability of closing the defect, your attitude towards closing the defect. So small VSDs have become the subject of intense controversy because of that. And based on that, people are using that bias to classify as moderate or small. And that's very important to be objective. When you come to that situation, you have to step aside if you are the interventionist and have an objective assessment which does not involve your bias. Because if you are the person doing an echo, you, that LA and LV will seem enlarged if you want to close the defect. And it's very important to have that equipoise, that objectivity, and that little distance from taking that decision. And I have to say that because over a period of time, this will, you know, initially you may want to do a lot of closures as you are getting good at it, but over a period of time, the complications that can result from unnecessary, unwanted closures of small VSP are quite substantial. So this is something I just wanted to pass on as a message. So again, I'll come back to definitions, small, moderate, large. And I'm going to use this paradigm, this construct. Small patient has, from history, you have no symptoms, you have no growth retardation. Physical exam, essentially an isolated murmur. So if it's a small VST, you have an isolated pan-systolic murmur. That's about it. The first heart sound is normal. The second heart sound is normal. No third heart sound, no flow murmur. If you have a PDA, you have an isolated continuous murmur. If it is slightly not so small, but with really small, you just have a systolic murmur. If you have an AST, you can't actually diagnose a small AST clinically. So that is what you get in physical exam. Chest X-ray is completely normal, ECG is normal, echo shows no chamber enlargement, no pulmonary hypertension, natural history is same as that of general population, intervention is not warranted. That's small, no confusion here, okay? Again, large, no confusion. Patient is symptomatic, failure to thrive strictly by the criteria that you follow in terms of Z-scores for the weight or, you know, percentiles, whatever. Physical exam shows heart failure, volume overload, clearly evident, very hyperdynamic precordium, evidence of pulmonary hypertension, X-ray shows cardiomegaly, increased vasculature, ECG shows features of atrial and ventricular enlargement, but I always take ECG with limited sensitivity, very limited sensitivity. Echo shows undoubted chamber enlargement, pulmonary hypertension, and natural history is adverse. So there is clearly two spectrum, there is no problem. Moderate is you have to be as objective as possible to decide where your line is going to come and whether you're going to send the patient for an intervention or a procedure or a surgery, or you're going to send the patient to just allow, ask the patient to just follow up. Now that is your judgment, and that happens with maturity, honesty, and objectivity. And based on all that I have told you, one thing I'll tell you, there are no numbers. There are no, each number has to be put in the context of age, weight, situation. So everything has to be taken together. That's how you classify it. I'm not going to give you any magic formulas to classify small, moderate, large, as you would do, let's say, for valve regurgitation in an adult. Small is so much, you have 5-6 criteria, and you have one grade 1, 2, 3, 4. I cannot do that here for the reasons that I have explained. The other thing is very important is to understand pre-tricuspid versus post-tricuspid, and you all know the difference. In pre-tricuspid, there's a gradual increase in QP as the RV accommodates and enlarges. ASD is a good example. PAPVC is a good example. Post-tricuspid, there is a direct transmission of pressure heads. So in VST, it's a systolic pressure. In PDA, AP window, it's a diastolic and systolic pressure that is transmitted directly into the from the aortic to the pulmonary, from the systemic to the pulmonary circulation. So pre-tricuspid shunt, there is progressive volume overload of RA and RV depending on the left to right shunt. And this is generally tolerated well, even if the QPQS goes up substantially. So that is, you know, gradually the RV dilates and accommodates very gradually over the entire infancy, childhood, early childhood, and the patient adapts and grows with the ASD. That happens 95%, 90 to 95% of the times. Patient is asymptomatic, normal exercise capacity, and typical story is that of incidental diagnosis. And that's pre-tricuspid shunt. Post-tricuspid, so example, physiology, you all have understood that the left atrium acts as a conduit. This slide, Dr. Kannan, my former colleague, has made along with the slides that follow. The right atrium and right ventricle dilate, which is downstream to the defect. Similarly, if you look at post-tricuspid shunts, these are the examples. Almost every congenital heart disease with increased pulmonary blood flow except for TAPVC is a post-tricuspid shunt in a way, because there is volume loading of left atrium and left ventricle. In this, the RV is the conduit. Why? Because both RV and LV contract together. So the shunt essentially finds its way into the lungs without volume loading the right ventricle. The left atrium and the left ventricle get volume loaded as a consequence because of the excessive pulmonary venous return. And you can imagine if this patient had an associated AST, then this may not happen. You may have then enlargement of right atrium and right ventricle. So pulmonary hypertension actually happens in every patient with large post-strike restriction. It's a part of all patients at all ages. So it's important to recognize that you have to make the distinction between pulmonary hypertension that is hyperdynamic and or flow related versus pulmonary hypertension that is related to increased resistance. A large defect basically equalizes pressures. So as a result, you have similar pressures. So I will stop with this, and then I will ask for presentations from the students. This was just to give you a framework, and I thought I'll take half an hour to do that today and provide you this essential framework of how we assess. And we will take examples from one present student after the other and try and use those examples to classify.
Dr. Kanhai can upload his presentation.
So if, while he's uploading, if there are any specific questions, I'm happy to take that also. And you can either post it in the chat box. I don't see Q&A. You can post it in the chat box. Or if there's any other way, I can also answer that. Okay, go ahead, please.
My first case is a 50-year-old female residing at the Shimoga, working at the local clinic, with presented with the chief complaint of breathlessness on exertion. It's progressed from grade 2 NYHA class 2 to class 3 for 2 years. But exertional fatigue, also same progress from class 2 to class 3 over 2 years. And palpitation on exertion, which was regular and gradual onset and offset for last 2 years. Mainly exertional breathlessness, fatigue, and palpitation for 2 years.
Okay, go on.
It's moving.
You can use this bottom, no? There is a switch. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
There is no any history of any orthopnea, PND, chest pain, pre-syncope or syncope or cyanosis. No any history of pedal edema, abdominal distension, nausea, vomiting.
That's fine.
No other history of, sir?
Yeah, go on. That's fine.
No any other history of prolonged fever, hematuria, skin lesion, or blackening of the finger. Past history, she was diagnosed 1 year back as a heart disease and started on diuretic, which was currently she is in NYHA class 2. She was born out of non-consanguineous marriage, no any other similar cardiac disease in the siblings, or no any other significant family history or personal history. On general examination, she was fairly built and nourished, height of around 149 cm with weight 44.5 kg, so BMI was around 20 kg per meter square. Arm span of 140 cm with upper segment 63 and lower segment was 86 cm. No any signs of icterus, pallor, cyanosis, clubbing, edema or lymphadenopathy. No any features of dysmorphic faces. No abnormal hairline, back and spine. On a general examination, temperature was 98 for Fahrenheit. Pulse was 80 per minute regular. Blood pressure was 130 by 80 mm in the sitting position. Respiratory was 18 per minute. Saturation was 97% in all four limbs. And all peripheral pulses are normal and palpable. JVP was pulsatile, 3 cm above the sternal angle of the Lewis in the sitting position. Above the clavicle and the sitting position. A and V wave are normal and equal. Normal descent, normal respiratory variation with absent hepatojugular reflux.
No, just stop here. You cannot say absent hepatojugular reflux once it is already elevated. So hepatojugular reflux is used to elicit subclinical right heart failure. Okay, this is an error you're making. You shouldn't do it in your exam. Okay.
Okay, sir.
You cannot talk about hepatojugular. See, all these things you guys do for the first time in the exam. You never do it in your clinic, I'm sure. To routinely, nobody does hepatojugular reflux. But if you do it, you should know why it is done. If you say it, you should know. So if you put it in the context of somebody with already elevated JVP,
correct. I've written for 3 cm from the sternal angle of the Lewis, but from above in the sitting position for clavicle, it was around just less than 1 cm.
Is it elevated or not?
No, not elevated, sir. Not elevated.
Okay, thanks. All right, go on. Then you don't have to say all this. You just say it's not elevate.
Okay. Inspection bulge present. Chest was bilateral symmetrical with no precordial bulge. Apex base was in left 6th intercostal space. It was just outside the mediclavicular line, around 11 centimeters from the mid-sternal line. It was around diffuse type, continuous with the parasternal heave. Grade 2 parasternal heave was noted. And a palpable P2 in second left intercostal space. No other impulse, carved sinuses or dilated veins or thrills.
Okay.
And percussion upper border of the liver drainage on right 5th intercostal space in the mediclavicular line. Left heart border corresponds with the apex. Right heart border with a 4 centimeter right to the sternal border. And left second intercostal space was dull. An auscultation, S1 was normal. H2 wide and fixed split with loud P2. No any S3, S4, click or opening snap was there. Another other murmurs for a grade 3/6 ejection systolic murmur, which was short, medium pitch, early peaking, crescendo decrescendo type in second left intercostal space at the parasternal region, not radiating to carotid and best heart with the diaphragm at the end expiration. And another grade 2 I4, short rumbling, low pitch, mid diastolic murmur, decrescendo, mid diastolic murmur, not radiating and best heart with the bell at the end expiration at the left lower sternal border. Other systemic examination was unremarkable.
Okay. You have a clinical diagnosis after this, can I?
Yes, sir.
Provisional diagnosis.
Situs solitus, levocardia, congenital asynotic heart disease, probably pre-tricuspid shunt physiology, moderate to large non-restrictive ostium secundum, ostium secundum ASD, significant left to right shunt, probable QP by QS more than 2:1. PH was moderate PH around, and probably patient is in currently so sinus rhythm.
We'll stop here and we will go through those two, point number 3 and point number 4. Okay. So that's what I was talking about all the in my lecture. Now, why did you have tried to hedge? You're saying that the left to right shunt is greater than 2:1, yet you want to say it is moderate to large. You're hesitant to say large. Can you explain why? What prevents you from calling this a large unrestrictive ASD? Is there anything that tells you that it is moderate in this patient? Why did you choose the word moderate? I'm not trying to pull your leg or make it difficult for you, but I want you to explain the reason behind why you're calling it moderate.
Other thing means in severe ASD, other thing like a JVP was ANV equal was there.
They are so telling how specific is JVP for ASD assessment? Now here you have a symptomatic 50-year-old with absolutely no doubt that this patient has a significant shunt based on your description. Hemodynamic consequences of the shunt. You have an MDM at the left lower sternal border. You have an ejection systolic murmur. You have a wide fixed split second heart sound, relatively loud P2. Is there any reason to call this moderate?
No, sir.
Then you should just say large. In the exam or in any other circumstance, when you are sure, don't bring in uncertainty. When you are certain, don't bring in uncertainty. You are certain. This is a large defect. Based on every single criteria that we have discussed, this should be classified as large. Okay. So I think it's important to be very clear on this and not say moderate to large, small to moderate, and try and sit on the fence.
Okay.
To make a commitment. Because you are saying in the same breath, left to right greater than 2:1. If it's left to right greater than 2:1, then why do you want to classify this as a moderate shunt? That's what I wanted to tell you. So it's important to say this. I use the criteria that I have described, which is there is clear hemodynamic evidence of a shunt and the patient is symptomatic. Okay. So there is no need to sit on the fence, call it a large shunt. But the question then arises as to why did you say that this patient has moderate TAH? On what basis?
Yeah.
Again, why did you choose moderate? Why did you say PH? You have to justify these two things. Other things are all straightforward. Only these two points are contentious.
Here we can because of the findings like a loud P2 it can be there because of only AS related because pulmonary will be dilated. And
so you said loud P2 and before that you described P2 is also being palpable, correct?
Yeah, palpable.
It P2 palpable means it's really loud and it is there. And you so has somebody worked out the likelihood that a loud P2 would predict pH in these patients?
No, so in ASD it can be also there without even pH.
Okay, and, but is there any other sign in
other parasternal heave? Parasternal heave grade 2 was there.
Grade 2 parasternal heave. So based on that, you feel that there is some pH.
Yeah.
Correct?
Yes, sir.
Is it easy to classify that severity by clinical examination?
No, sir.
So you be honest and say there is pulmonary, there is perhaps there is pulmonary hypertension based on a parasternal heave.
Mm.
A loud P2 is not an accurate indicator of pulmonary hypertension. However, a palpable P2 may suggest that P2, there indeed is some pulmonary hypertension. What is the third clue to suggest that this patient may have pulmonary hypertension? The third clue, which is very important, is your history. When an adult patient with an ASD starts to develop symptoms, the chances are fairly high that that is because of pulmonary hypertension. So this lady has symptoms for the last 2 years, correct?
Yes, sir.
And recent worsening. That is, these are the patients where you have to be concerned about the possibility of development of pulmonary hypertension. In this adult patient, however, you may have other causes also. The patient may be developing maybe some evidence of stiffening of the right left ventricle. 50 years of age, they often become symptomatic. But these are the three reasons why you would consider pulmonary hypertension. However, I think if I were you, I'll just say pulmonary hypertension, uncertain severity, you can't classify it based on clinical exam. And that's good enough. The question I'm going to ask you is the pulmonary vascular resistance elevated, likely to be elevated or not? Based on your evaluation.
Cannot be severe. If you're elevated, it can be mild because QP upon QS is still more than 2:1.
So no, don't say QP upon QS. You're hearing a mid-diastolic flow murmur in the
left.
That is something which doesn't happen if the patient becomes inoperable in ASD. No. Okay, so it's very important. The patient is pink, 97% saturation. There are flow murmurs across both the tricuspid valve and the pulmonary valve, suggestive of still substantial increased pulmonary blood flow. Okay, so let's now go to the next investigation. You can show me that ECG or X-ray that you have. Okay, let's interpret this ECG. This is very nice. Can you just show me what the what? Can you describe this ECG findings, please?
In this 12-lead ECG, I can the patient is in a sinus rhythm. Heart rate is around 80 to 90 per minute, and we can see the V1 axis. Axis is around. Rightward axis.
No, not really rightward.
Not
rightward. Axis is okay actually.
Yeah, near. Mainly V1 is suggestive of like RS, RDS pattern is there.
Yes.
And other
so
thing
what
is
not there? We talked about pH. You put this ECG in your clinical context. Okay, never mind. I don't want you to go through all the small features, but put it in your clinical context. What did you expect to see and what you are seeing?
V1 RS ratio should be more than 1 at least.
So if there is RVH, if there's pulmonary hypertension, you might have expected some RVH, but again, nobody knows the sensitivity specificity of that particular sign. So that's one thing that you find RSR dash, you find features of right ventricular volume overload, but you don't find evidence of right ventricular hypertrophy. The other thing that is worth commenting on, which actually people don't look at enough, and I'm going to ask Mukund to weigh in on this, is the P wave morphology. Of course, the P wave is not tall at all. It's all gone. It's become flattened. But what you see in AVL is a very broad P wave.
Okay.
A very broad, you know, fragmented sort of P wave, which is occupying a lot of spaces out there. And that is a feature that may indicate an harbinger of this patient going into an atrial, sustained atrial arrhythmia, like atrial flutter or fibrillation. this is a feature that happens relatively late as the atrium enlarges. Initially, you have tall peak P waves, P pulmonale, but as the atrium continues to enlarge, the P waves, the potential occupies a lot more area. So I think Mukund can elaborate on this.
I absolutely agree, sir. We expect usually a well-formed P wave in the usual AST. Even in sinus venous AST, though the books say abnormal P wave access, we hardly encounter it. But as the atrium enlarges and scars, P wave morphology, intra-atrial conduction time tends to get prolonged, and you get flattish sort of or wide, very wide P waves. And PR prolongation is another feature useful in AST linked with familial AST.
Yes, yes, definitely.
Yet another feature I like to highlight in this ECG is a small Q wave in AVL. Can you tell any significance of that? It may or may not be right because ECG is not very specific, neither it's very sensitive in congenital heart disease. But when you have such a patient, what would be your thoughts in your exam, for example, if you see such Q waves in AVL?
For a counterclockwise axis, mainly.
It's not counterclockwise axis, it's counterclockwise loop.
Loop.
It's counterclockwise loop.
How is it important in your case? In a patient with AST, it may be a marker of ostium primum AST or AV canal defect.
Okay.
Again, it may or may not be right, but chances are fairly high.
Yeah. Say that again. Sorry. When you have this counterclockwise loop, it's a feature of
ostium primum AST or an AV canal defect.
What is that's a possibility. What is going slightly against it?
Want to take the question?
So you don't have a frank left axis deviation, but you have a counterclockwise loop. So that is something which is slightly going against it. But remember, we have examples of ostium primum ASDs without left axis deviation. We also have examples of secundum ASDs with left axis deviation. Can you tell me one or two causes of secundum ASD which has left axis deviation? So when you have secundum ASD in the context of Noonan's, okay? So when you have somebody with secundum ASD and Noonan's, so that is something that you have to remember, okay? So with Noonan syndrome, you can have that. But it's important to pay attention. I think the point that Mukund brought out was very nice. Let's go to the X-ray.
Sir, can I interrupt for a second, sir?
Sure, Dr. Sudhakar.
Then ECG, somebody has asked about this Crocketage, which is there in this ECG. How sensitive it is for a ostium secundum ASD, sir?
The sensitivity has not been worked out in terms of the, but it is a fairly good indicator of the likelihood of there being a second ASD or ASD as such.
So another question, they ask is, how do you differentiate in this case, whether it's a hyperkinetic or a hypertensive PH, like based on clinically, sir?
Based on clinical, I think you can see that this patient has evidence. So the term hyperkinetic and PAH associated with increased PVR, that term is more applicable for post-tricuspid shunts. When you come to pre-tricuspid shunts, you don't often use the word hyperkinetic PAH because any PAH that happens in a pre-tricuspid shunt often has results from some elevation in pulmonary vascular resistance because there is no transmission of pressure during systole. It's all the blood is received by the right ventricle in diastole and that is ejected into the pulmonary artery. So if there is any elevation in pulmonary artery pressures, it has to result from increased pulmonary vascular resistance. So in general, just to summarize, we don't use the word hyperkinetic versus fixed pulmonary vascular resistance elevation in the context of ASD, particularly in adults.
Right. That's one last question they asked is that cardiomegaly in this case, like the apex is downward and outward, does it have any clinical significance related to severity in this case?
It just probably results from very significant right ventricular enlargement. So the right ventricle pushes the left ventricle and you have an apex that is also pushed out. So you expect the right ventricle to be significantly enlarged in a 50-year-old with a large AST, which is your clinical diagnosis. So I wouldn't be surprised if there is cardiomegaly in these patients.
Yes.
So can we see the X-ray? Okay, you interpret this, Kanai.
Yes, in a chest X-ray peer view, we can see clearly the cardiomegaly is there. Along with the, we can clearly say the right atrial enlargement we can see. It occupies more than two intercostal space, vertically. And main pulmonary artery looks dilated. And pulmonary vascular markings are more prominent.
So you have to tell me, what are the evidences of increased pulmonary blood flow on this X-ray? It's an important X-ray conceptually, and everybody needs to see, because here, this is very important in classifying shunt size. So what is the evidence of increased QP in this patient?
It's like,
there are two evidences.
MPA is dilated. And
no, that is not evidence of increased QP. MPA dilatation will happen if there is high PVR also. I want you to tell me, what is the evidence of increased QP, pulmonary vascular blood flow? Okay. What is the evidence of that being increased?
And so we can see the pulmonary vascular markings even in distally
periphery.
Near the pulmonary.
Okay, so you're able to see an outer one third. That is one. Second, more specific. This is something, again, people don't register very much. What you're seeing, and if I can, actually, I'm not able to mark it for you, but you are sharing the screen, but if you take on the fourth rib of on the right side, yeah, there, you're coming very close to mine. No, a little higher. That's perfect. What do you call that? That white
endon
shadow?
Endon vessel.
Okay, that's an endon vessel. Now we'll just go back to the sixth intercostal space. You see one more here. That's just to the right. Yeah, perfect. And then one below that, you see that? One more endon vessel. Then you see maybe a few more crowded out here. You can't be very sure. On the left side, they're all behind. Lots of endon vessels, but they're all behind the heart shadow. Mm. Okay, now these endon vessels are significant if they are more than twice the size of the adjacent endon bronchus, which you can see. Okay. They're quite large. You see, in this case, it's huge in comparison to the endon bronchus out here. So these are significant endon vessels. Now, this is also a very important sign. The number of endon vessels, 3 to 5 per lung field, and the fact that you see vessels to the periphery. These are two very good signs of increased pulmonary blood flow. In addition, so that's very important, because you find that the right pulmonary artery is gigantic in this patient. You see, this right pulmonary artery is occupying so much, you know, at the hilum. And that is very large, and then you're worried that, because the diameter seems to taper off quite quickly, but fortunately the patient has vessels going right to the periphery, and you have these endon vessels that seem to suggest that this patient has increased pulmonary blood.
Okay.
So this is very important that you register all these signs. So it's a hemodynamically significant AST. Your right atrium will continue to be enlarged in these patients if they have PAH also. Your cardiomegaly will persist if there's PAH, if there's evidence of increased pulmonary vascular resistance. But the vasculature that you're seeing in the peripheral lung fields will not be like this. Nonetheless, you have to be careful when you take a decision in this patient. You can't still say this patient is definitely operable. You may need to want to look at the echo, and then you may need to want to, I will talk about it after that. Go on.
Okay, sir. And Nico, I have just...
So 27
ostium second ASD with
left. Again, you are using mild to moderate PAH with mild TR. Please tell me RVSP. Don't have to use the word mild to moderate.
RVSP was around 50 plus RA pressure was there.
50 plus RA is a significant moderate. PA systolic pressure elevation in this patient. But at that time, what was the systemic blood pressure? All very important, you know. Because
it's not a hypertensive, sir.
Yeah, but even if it was 140 systolic or 130 systolic at the time that the patient was evaluated in the echo room, then your 50 may not be that significant. But if you have a systolic of 90 and you have a RVSP of 50, it becomes significant. So this is probably not too bad. You can accept this pressures. We'll put everything else in context and take a call. Okay.
Of course, this.
Right. So that's it. You have any other investigations in this patient? That's all?
No, sir. That's all.
That's all. Okay, now we have to take a decision. Let us assume that this patient is not suitable for device. Okay?
Okay, sir.
And you're sending this patient to surgery.
Okay.
And let us say her age is not 50, but let's make her age 42. And let's say she's premenopausal.
Okay.
What will you catheterize this patient, or will you send straight to surgery? You're going to have to make these decisions wherever you work. Are you confident that this patient will be operable? There'll be no problems. Based on all what you've told me.
Yeah. Sir, our BP was around 130 was there at the time you were asked.
Never mind.
I'm taking the pH.
We've closed that chapter. You got all the data with you. You are the cardiologist. You are working. Which city do you belong to, Kanai?
Currently, I'm studying in Manipal, sir. Yeah.
But where are you from?
From Gujarat, sir. Rajkot.
Okay, let's say you go back to Rajkot. You are the only cardiologist there. There's a surgeon asking you. There's a lady who presents to you. And you have to take a decision. Are you going to cath her or not?
Yeah, sir.
Why? How will it change?
I have a doubt about in the pH.
You have doubts? What is your doubt? You said 50 is your RVSP. You still want to measure the PA pressures and get QPQS and everything else, or are you feeling reasonably confident you can actually send this patient? So this is a very important question. Yeah. And I think every postgraduate listening in needs to understand this question. Okay. I am not going to pin you down for an answer. If you say you're going to catheterize to make yourself more comfortable, that's a reasonable choice, particularly if you are having to make a difficult decision. I will not, challenge you one way or the other. But from all the data that you've provided, I'm fairly confident that this patient is likely to be operable. Okay. There is some pulmonary hypertension, but still the left to right shunt is substantial. There is a mid diastolic flow murmur. There is ECG. There is X-ray evidence of, increased pulmonary blood flow. It's perhaps reasonable in that situation. Now, if she's postmenopausal, you may want to catheterize her to ensure that you do a coronary angio and make sure that the coronaries are normal. And then in that time, if you're catheterizing for coronaries, it may as well get the PA pressures and QPQS, et cetera, et cetera. But let's take some opinions from the faculty here. Dr. Sudhakar, Dr. Mukund, what are your thoughts?
Yeah, sir, I go with your what you told, because I think here it said all the indicators are there. It's a significance and I may not catheterize her.
Mukund, it's a difficult situation sometimes. And Kanhai, I'm not going to hold it against you if you want to catheterize, if you want to be sure. And perhaps when you go into your practice and you see five or six such patients similarly, and then you become fairly confident, okay, I think I can send this patient without a cath. But you have to understand the principles. That is more important. Once you understand your principles, then you become far more confident in these situations. Okay. Very good. I think we should go on in the interest of time to the next case.
And I have just one more question, sir.
Yeah, sure.
What benefit will we give her if she is 50-55 now?
Absolutely. Actually, not apart from arrhythmia. Arrhythmia will not change for sure.
Yeah, right, sir. Right.
This patient will, the risk of long-term arrhythmia will not change, but this lady is symptomatic. Yes. And by all means, her symptoms will improve. So there is definitely, there are lots of studies which talk about benefits of closing ASDs in 40-year-olds, 50-year-olds, and even 60-year-olds. There is benefit if there is absolutely no doubt about it. If they have symptoms, they feel much better. And that is one very important reason to intervene. Natural history, arrhythmias is not altered after this age, particularly once you see a kind of P-wave morphology, you're very worried that she will have atrial flutter. You have to have plan towards long-term anticoagulation, monitoring for atrial flutter and fibrillation in the long-term, and accordingly counsel the family. You have to do that. In terms of survival, there is slightly conflicting data, but even that is improved. If you have a large resting shunt in this fashion, of this kind, then they definitely are much better, because as they get older, they're just going to get worse. So I think there is nothing wrong in closing this debate.
Thank you, sir. Dr. Kanhai can stop share screen.
Okay.
Thank you, Kanhai. It was a very good presentation.
Thank you, sir.
Dr. Pratibhan, can you start sharing your screen?
Okay, Pratibhan, you can present your case. We are not able to hear you, Pratibhan. I think you're muted.
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, now you're audible.
Okay, sir. Good evening, respected sir and dear colleagues. Presenting you his case scenario, a 17-year-old female is presenting to us with a history of exertional palpitation and NIHARD class 2 to 3, for the past 3 years, which is regular and decreases with rest, that is NIHARD class 2 to 3, and there is no associated dizziness or syncope. And there is exertional breathlessness for the past 15 months, which is also from worsening from NIHARD class 2 to 3 for the past 15 months, and patient did not have any episodes of orthopnea or paroxysmal nocturnal dyspnea. As the patient continues to be symptomatic, she took medical advice and she was found to have a hole in the heart, and she underwent a procedure through right groin, after which she was advised surgery.
Okay.
Examination. The patient is comfortable at rest, moderately built and nourished. There is no features of dysmorphism. The pulse rate is 110 per minute, regular, normal volume, no specific character. Blood pressure is 106 by 70 millimeters of mercury in the right upper limb, 110 by 70 in the left upper limb, and 118 by 80 in the right lower limb, with a saturation of 96% on the lumen. JVP is pulsatile with normal wave pattern, 3 centimeters above the sternal angle with normal respiratory variation. Typical impulse is seen in the left cyst intercostal space, lateral to the midclavicular line, and is hyperdynamic in nature. There is palpable P2 with a systolic thrill in the left lower sternal border, and there is grade 2 left parasternal heat. On auscultation, the S1 is normal, S2 is wide and variable split, P2 is low, and there is LV S3 plus, there is no S4. There is a high-pitched pan-systolic murmur of uniform intensity of grade 4 by 6 is heard in the left fourth intercostal space, the diaphragm of the stethoscope. Patient is in supine position and breath held in expiration. A high-pitched crescendo-decrescendo ejection systolic murmur of grade 3 by 6 is heard in the pulmonary area, and a low-pitched rough rumbling MDM of grade 2 by 4 is heard in the apex with the bell of the stethoscope, and patient is left lateral position and breath held in expiration.
I'll stop you here. And yes, this is a little bit of a concern I have.
Yes, sir.
When you describe two murmurs of very similar nature at very close to each other, and you want to separate them as two different murmurs, you have a pan-systolic murmur that is 4 by 6 in the left lower sternal region, and you're hearing just a couple of spaces above, you're hearing a systolic murmur. It's very difficult to distinguish between the two. So if you want to say they are two separate murmurs, you have to be very sure. And I'm just wanting to put that across right now.
Yes.
Okay, that's one. The second thing is, why do you have to keep saying diaphragm of the stethoscope when you have 4 by 6? It doesn't matter.
Yes, sir.
Okay, next.
So, sir.
So it's a 17-year-old who has these physical findings. So what's your diagnosis?
Sir,
you have to give me a clinical diagnosis.
Yes, sir. Probably first thinking in terms of a shunt physiology, a post-tricuspid shunt.
Yeah, post-tricuspid shunt.
With probably a large ventricular septal defect with a hyperkinetic pulmonary hypertension. Currently, patient in NIHARD class 2, in sinus rhythm and no features of infection.
Okay, so you feel that there is hyperkinetic pulmonary hypertension, correct?
Yes, sir.
Hyperkinetic pulmonary hypertension. And you want to explain those two murmurs because you have decided to commit on these two murmurs. So quickly tell me about what would be the basis of the ejection systolic murmur if there you think there is a VST. I think we'll go back to that slide on the murmurs. Yeah. I'll come back. I'll reason why it's important and relevant to this patient.
Yes, sir. Because of increased flow.
There is an associated pulmonary stenosis, or what do you think?
Because of increased flow across the pulmonary valves, because of the large.
So you feel that that is related to, and that does that happen? You know, usually you cannot identify that as a separate murmur and VST. That can happen in an ASD, where you know you have no other cause of a murmur. Here it becomes very difficult to distinguish between the two, and it's very important to understand that in VST, what is happening is that the VS ventricles, both the ventricles are contracting. The pulmonary valve is already open when much of the shunt is happening. So it's very difficult to tell whether that murmur really comes from the pulmonary valve or from the VST. So in any case, the point I'm trying to make is, what are the odd features here, unusual features in this child?
One is a large VST presenting at 17 years of age.
Right, that's right. So this is a very unusual case. No, you have to be very careful before we classify and understand what it is, and you have to be absolutely sure before you make a recommendation.
Yes.
So at 17, if it's presenting at this age and you have a loud murmur, so it's one of those cases which seem to be reasonably large, at the same time did not result in irreversible pulmonary vascular resistance. As a result, patient is still presented because she's symptomatic, but it's interesting how she has still remains operable in this situation. And I think this is a concept that we can discuss at some point, because you do have these exceptional patients that you see every now and then that remain operable despite the fact that they are in their age range where you expect them to be inoperable. Okay. What are the other possibilities? You can't be dogmatic here, okay? Yes. So what are the other possibilities which would have allowed her to be where she is? You yourself said that there is some flow acceleration across the pulmonary valve.
Yes.
And you know, to be very honest,
sir, ASD can present actually with the Luttenbacher syndrome or ASD with the idiopathic pulmonary hypertension.
ASD with Luttenbacher, you would have had a mid-diastolic flow murmur at the tricuspid valve. So you are very sure about the MDM at apex.
Yeah.
So you're dealing with a post-tricuspid. Within this construct of post-tricuspid, if somebody presents at this age, you need to think of some possibilities. Simple things, common things first. So you should think of a right ventricular outflow tract obstruction that is mild. Okay,
yes,
I never get dogmatic on pan-systolic versus ejection systolic. When you have 4/6 murmur, it becomes really hard. We honestly, you really can't tell. So if you have a very loud and long murmur, it could well be resulting from a VST-PS situation, and the patient still has increased pulmonary blood flow, but there is some amount of restriction of flow across the pulmonary valve. So this is something which you should think of when you have this kind of a presentation. Okay, so very important to remember that. The other important subtle thing, which I don't think you'll find in textbooks, is patients for a given size, subpulmonic VSTs tend to produce louder murmurs and larger shunts when compared to perimembranous VSTs. So this finding, this patient could also have a subpulmonic VST, which can, you know, manifest in this fashion. So these are all the possibilities I would like to think of in this particular case. Okay, we can see the X-ray and ECG.
This 12-lead ECG with a normal standardization showing sinus rhythm with a heart rate of 120 per minute. With the P wave normal, no obvious left atrial enlargement. Axis is plus 70 to 80 degrees. The prominent R wave in V1 with R by S ratio is still less than 1, and predominant LV forces.
I think V1 does not have prominent R wave. It's clearly no, there is absolutely no evidence of RVH. That's what, yes, if you're trying to point towards that, there's really no evidence. And are the lateral leads half standardized, isn't it? Okay, so predominantly significant LV forces are there. There is a little bit of resting tachycardia, which is interesting. Okay, this child's got some resting tachycardia, which may suggest And then what else? That's it. I can't see anything. There are Q waves in one AVL, V5, V6, suggestive of maybe can be interpreted as RV, LV volume overload, but I'm not sure.
Yes.
Okay. All right. X-ray. Good. Interpret this. Interesting.
It's a chest X-ray PA view with cardiomegaly with an LV type of apex. And there is
I don't think you should say LV type of apex. It's really not clear to me, honestly.
Okay.
And because you're a little biased here, I would be very hesitant to call it LV apex because I can't see the apex from the breast shadow. Okay. And very difficult for me to say that. Then?
With increased pulmonary.
Before that, chamber enlargement. Can you comment on the left atrial and left atrium? Is there evidence of left atrial enlargement?
Sir, there is double density sign.
More than double density, you can see the
slight
widening of the carina.
Yes, sir. The left bronchus is slightly elevated. Yes, sir.
Yeah, so I think there is evidence of left atrial enlargement.
Enlargement.
For sure. But MPA shadow is prominent, and that's very interesting.
Yes,
and then?
Sir. And then with the features of pulmonary plethora showing endon vessels.
That is not as prominent as the previous patient. The endons are really small.
Yes, sir.
And you can see that the endon vessels are seen, but they're not striking. You know, again, we have realized that everything has to be taken with a pinch of salt, but they add up. So here, I'm not absolutely sure about the, there is subtle evidence of increased pulmonary blood flow, not as florid as the previous patient. Okay, next.
There is,
that's it.
That's it. Prominent.
Okay. So what's your conclusion based on X-ray ECG? It's still compatible with your existing diagnosis of a large or
it's still compatible with the post-tracheal structure or the large VSD with the pulmonary hypertension. Still
now, what doesn't fit with the large VSD here is the very loud murmur, isn't it?
Loud murmur.
Grade 4/6.
Yes, sir.
So it is restrictive. One way or the other, it's a restrictive VSD.
Restrictive large and flow murmur across
so
the mitral valve.
No. Wait. Restrictive large is very careful you have to be.
Yes, sir.
When you say restrictive and large, you're using slightly two words which are conflicting with each other.
Yes.
Now you have to, we are talking about shunt size quantification. We have to come to a decision on how significant this shunt is. So this is exactly the kind of cases that we need to discuss. This is in fact a very good case. So this is cannot be classified as large in some ways because large is in the minds of most of us is unrestricted. Okay. This is a restrictive VST, yet QPQS is significant. Understood? So where does it fall in that spectrum? Where should we call it moderate?
Moderate restrictive. Moderate restrictive VST.
No, moderate restrictive also, again, I'm not sure. I would say it's restrictive VST, but the QPQS could be significant. I'm not sure again. I'll just say it is perhaps not large. It is definitely not small. It's reasonable to call it moderate, but let us see further.
Yes,
she's had cath and everything. You can show me all the other things.
Yeah.
We'll interpret that also, no? It'll be very useful here.
Yeah. So, echocardiography was showing cytosolitis, levocardia, large perimembranous VST with a predominant.
So, the large has to be defined. Now, you can give measurements. Why don't they measure the.
Ah, yes, sir. It is 24 centimeter. Sorry, 2.4 centimeter. Sorry, 24 mm.
2.4, can it produce a murmur? Something is wrong here. If you have a 2.4 centimeter VSD, it is gigantic. It is bigger than aortic annulus. You should not get that 4/6 murmur. So you have to give me an explanation for that 4/6 murmur. Harsh 4/6 murmur with trill.
Yes.
Certainly, it is not the TR that is producing it. And if you say it's a 24 millimeter VSD, that also cannot explain that murmur. You have to give me an explanation. You don't have the echo pictures, it's okay. Let's go on to the next setup. Whatever you have, you show me. You understand what I'm
yes,
saying?
Sir,
you can't call.
Yeah. Yes,
because they all have to fit into one clear, easily. All the findings that you have described have to be consistent with each other.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Next.
So, we need to get
the. Okay. please interpret where is saturation?
Saturation next table, sir. This is
show me that first. Yes. Come back to the saturation first. Okay, now you tell me what is the okay. Now let's look at all this. So what is the step up?
Step from up is
60 to 85, isn't it?
68 to 81, yes, sir.
60 to 85. You want to use Flam formula, 65 to 85, 20% step up.
Yes.
Okay?
Yes, sir.
So we have 20% step up. Why do you have aortic desaturation? I'm not going to look at post oxygen.
Yes, sir.
You are having a step down from pulmonary vein to aorta. That we need to explain, okay? That is something that we cannot understand based on your physical findings. I can think of some reasons, but you have to come up with it. Now tell me, based on this, calculate PPQS ratio. 85 minus 65,
yes,
okay? And
91 minus 64.
Sorry, 85 minus not 65. 85 minus
91 minus 64, sir.
79 minus 65.
Sir,
27. How much is that?
27, sir.
27
divided by
27.
Ah, yes, sir.
And then 98 minus 85.
It's 13, sir. Almost 2:1. Sir.
Minus 85. How much?
13. 13. 27 okay. By 13.
You get a PPQS ratio of 13.
Yes,
that's right. 2:1. It's correct. You're getting 2:1 ratio. And that is substantially because you have some resting aortic desaturation, which is interesting in this patient. Post oxygen, I will not look because you are not telling me the dissolved oxygen. That is not valid.
Yes.
Go back to the previous slide now. Let us look at the hemodynamics. Okay. So RV and PA, there is no gradient. So your that gradient theory goes, correct?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
What you have is a subsystemic PA pressures. But the PA pressure elevation is significant, almost to a severe level.
Yes,
okay. In by some criteria, it would be severe. By systolic criteria, it's severe. By mean pressure criteria, it is moderate, but it's significant PAH. Okay.
Yes.
Now, can you explain the physical findings? Such a loud murmur, MDM. Can you explain on basis of 4x6 murmur with this kind of pressure difference? I'm unable to slightly explain that. You understand? I would have expected your PA systolic to be less than 50 if you had that pan systolic murmur. Now you have a significant elevation in PA pressure. Nonetheless, I'll accept your findings are your findings. I cannot challenge it. So, you have more calculations?
Oh, yes,
pulmonary
sir.
Vascular resistance.
Yeah, I'll calculate it.
Yes, show me all the.
Sir, yes. Oxygen content. This is.
Yeah, so let's come to PVR. The resting PVR is high,
5.4
units.
Yes, sir.
Okay? And PVR SVR ratio is 0.2.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And your QPQS that you got is 2.5 in this particular. Using the Flam formula, actually it's from 2.2 or something like that. Okay, now
yes.
Based on all this, what do you recommend? You have seen the X-ray, ECG, echo. Only thing I think there is something which is wrong, which is your echo assessment of VSD size. The 2.4
yes.
centimeters doesn't seem right to me.
Yes, I'll just check.
Okay, now tell me, how will you take a decision in this patient?
You see, look for reversibility, sir.
You've already given oxygen and
yes, sir.
That data is extremely fallacious, but we can show the oxygen data.
Yes, sir.
Show the oxygen data. Post-oxygen QPQ, because you've done all that, no?
Yes,
you've calculated dissolved oxygen.
Yes, sir.
So,
sir.
Dissolved oxygen post
yes,
M,
yes, sir. 0.003 into everything, sir. Everything. Yes, sir.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, sir.
So Parthiban, can you hear me?
Hello, sir. Hello.
Can you hear me now, Parthiban?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
So now show me what was the calculations on oxygen QPQS.
That slide I didn't add, sir, with the post-oxygen.
Post-oxygen QPQS, you don't have the numbers.
That numbers, I didn't type it, sir. I just thought I will show
you. So yeah, you got it here, man. Everything is there. Post-oxygen, your QPQS is 2.01. The FPR is so much. And you feel that oxygen is a reasonable vasodilator. There is some doubts in all its utility. So what do you want to do with her? What do you recommend?
This patient still comes under operable hemodynamics only. So
you can't be so sure. I'll be a little, I also would recommend surgery. I don't have doubts about it. But I want to tell all of you that you have to be a little careful here. This is a 17-year-old.
Yes, sir.
And when you go to PVR of 5.4 resting,
yes, sir,
you have to be a little worried. The absolute safe limit is four units.
Okay.
Between 4 to 8 is a slightly borderline zone.
Okay.
Above 8 is generally considered inoperable. Okay. So in this situation, and I only go by resting data, I don't go by post oxygen data at all.
Okay.
And it's been shown time in and time out that oxygen data is of no value in these circumstances. So what you have to do is you have to look at the post at the basal data, and the basal data clearly suggests that this patient needs to be handled with little care.
Yes,
overall, everything put together, clinical exam, x-ray, ECG, and echo, everything put together along with CAT, we would give benefit of doubt to the patient, but follow the patient very carefully. The question is, will you want the surgeon to fenestrate the ASD?
Fenestrated VSD closure.
Or the VSD, or either of them? Tell me.
Fenestrated VSD closure would be.
No, I don't think it's necessary to fenestrate this VSD. You can have problems postoperatively. I would not. It's again a judgment call, but it's not such a borderline case. When you have a loud murmur, mid diastolic, low murmur, I don't think you need to worry about.
Okay, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
So, can we have. What did you do with this patient?
The patient actually was sent for a surgical closure of the VSD.
Has she had a surgery or not?
Yeah, she had, sir. She,
how was the post-operative result?
Post-operative result, she was stable, sir, not much of complication.
No, not stable. I want to know what happened to PA pressures.
PA pressures were, the echo-wise, it was around 40, sir. So we just have to follow up with the cath lab.
Okay, so 40 is the RV systolic based on TR.
Yeah, yes, sir.
All right. And how early is the post-op? When have you seen her after surgery?
This was third or fourth post-operative.
Okay, fine. Now, the important thing is this patient needs close follow-up. You'll be surprised. Some of these patients develop late PAH and you have to watch out. You can't completely give her a clean chit.
Okay,
you don't have to start pulmonary vasodilators, but you have to keep a watch on this patient. Because 17 years for a large VSD is a relatively late age to operate, especially once some pulmonary hypertension has set in. So you need to be a little cautious, careful on follow-up. She will do well. My expectation is she'll do quite well, but you have to watch out. Okay, so let's do the last case, or actually we have two more cases, I think. So we'll do both quickly.
Dr. Deepanjan can share his slide. Sir, I just have a short question here. Like we are discussing, in case there is a mild PS, sir. So
I'm
in that case,
just, will there be a... sharing.
Yeah, no, go ahead, Dr. Sudhakar, please.
Sir, we discussed in case if this case had a mild PS, in that case, will there be a mid-diastolic murmur across the mitral line?
Yes, if the QPQS is large, you can still get a mid-diastolic murmur.
Right.
Because it's dictated by the pulmonary blood flow more than anything else. So Deepanjan, I'll take your case, but I have to wind up at 7, because 7, maybe at most 7:10, 7:15, because I have another webinar. So let's do your case quickly. Come on.
Dipanjan, you can go to full screen and start. I think you are mute.
Yeah. You can unmute yourself, Dipanjan.
Okay, sir. Just 1 second. So my case is a 4.5 month old girl.
Okay, very good.
System
can
got...
you just it's all right. You can go on and tell me. 4.5 month old girl.
I think Dr. Dipanjan has got disconnected, maybe.
We could do somebody else's also. If there is
Dr. Harnish, you can share your screen.
Yes, I'll just start sharing. Yeah. Is it visible, sir?
It's coming.
You started sharing, so we'll...
I am visible and audible, sir?
Yes, right. Both visible and audible. And you're on slide. I can see the slides.
Okay.
Yes, go on.
So this was a five-year-old boy, sir, was resident of Jaipur, presented with complaints of poor weight gain since birth and recurrent episodes of pneumonia. Am I audible?
Yes, very much so. Very much so.
So recurrent episodes of pneumonia requiring hospitalizations since 3 years and palpitations since 3 years. Born as a healthy child with a birth weight of 3 kilograms with no perinatal complications. However, his weight gain has been poor since birth. Mother states he also appears shorter than the rest of the children of his age. He also has sweating while feeding during the infantile period. However, no suck cycles were observed by the parents. He has had multiple hospital admissions for respiratory infections since 3 years, admitted 4 times, and treated on OPD basis several times. Mother also complains of prominent chest pulsations, which she has noticed since 3 years. These pulsations are present all the time, according to her. There's no history of cyanosis or cyanotic spells. There's no history of fever, joint pains, or joint swellings. There's no history of facial or lower limb swelling or syncope or abnormal movements. Perinatal history, he was born of a non-consanguineous marriage.
I think we can cut this short, man. We can go on to the next.
Among the milestones...
Not required. Yeah. Okay. Go ahead with the physical exam because we are really running short of time. Yes.
So let's focus on this. Child is lying supine on the bed, is active and alert, smiling comfortable, no pyloricterus, clubbing cyanosis, lymphadenopathy or edema. He has severe hearing loss with bilateral cataract and broad forehead with flattened cheeks and nasal bridge, down slanting palpable fissure. Weight was 14 kilograms, which is 10th percentile for his age. Height is 101 centimeter, which is 3rd percentile for his age. BMI is 13.7 kg per meter square. Pulse rate is 130 per minute, regular, high volume. Collapsing pulse is present, no radioradial or radiofemoral delay. All peripheral pulses are palpable. Blood pressure was 126/16, right upper limb in supine position with pediatric size cuff. Respiratory rate 22 per minute, thoracic abdominal, and there's no use of accessory muscles of respiration. JVP is not elevated, 3 centimeter above the sternal angle, normal waveforms. Temperature is normal, saturation 99% in all 4 limbs, and bounding peripheral pulses are present. On inspection, chest wall symmetrical, normal precordium, apex impulse in the 6th left intercostal space, lateral to the midclavicular line with medial retraction. No visible scars, sinuses, dilated veins, and no other pulsations. Apex beat on palpation is in left 6th intercostal space, 2 cm lateral, forceful, ill-sustained, localized. Systolic thrill is present in the left 2nd intercostal space. No parasternal heave, no other pulsations. Percussion-wise, left heart border at the level of apex corresponds to apex beat, and right heart border is retrosternal. Right second intercostal space is resonant, left second intercostal space is dull. First heart sound is heard at the apex, normal intensity, no splitting. And second heart sound is heard all over the precordium, normal intensity, paradoxically split, which is heard only in expiration, and no other sounds. Then a continuous rumbling murmur heard all over the precordium, best heard at the left infraclavicular area, grade 4/6, maximum intensity near S2 and extending up to late diastole. Rest of the systems are normal.
Okay. So this is very straightforward. That you're presenting, but there's only one thing I'd like to comment for the sake of the rest of the postgraduates. Your findings are very classical, typical, but there's one thing that worries me a little bit. You're very precise. I would be very hesitant to comment on the specifics of the second heart sound when you have such a loud continuous murmur. So it's very important. Again, the previous patient person also described a systolic murmur in the context of a grade 4/6 murmur, separate systolic murmur. So here is where I would like you guys to be very honest and understand the limitations of physical exam. To identify a paradoxical split amidst a grade 4/6 murmur that is, you know, really loud in that region, I think it's okay if you say I cannot make out the second heart sound clearly because the murmur, continuous murmur, is very loud. I have personally not been able to identify a paradoxically split second heart sound when you have a grade 4/6 murmur. So I would caution you for this.
The intensity of the heart sounds were slightly doubtful, but the split was, even despite the murmur, it was audible because the murmur was... Yeah.
Then there's full credit to you. I would just tell the other postgraduates, if you can't make that out, a paradoxical split, say I couldn't make it out. That's what I'm trying to say. You would not lose any points. Just for the sake of everybody to understand, because we all work with limitations when it comes to physical exam. Okay, go on.
So on the basis of clinical examination, it appears to be asymptomatic CSG with post-tricuspid shunt, a moderately restrictive PDSA.
So we are using a lot of these terms very loosely. Small to moderate, large, large and restrictive, moderately restrictive. We shouldn't do that. Okay. I think you can say that this is a restrictive PDA with a significant left-right shunt. The word moderate doesn't exist out here.
Right.
It's a restrictive PDA because you have a murmur. And right. The significant left to right shunt because you have all those features.
Right.
Which is, what are the features of a significant left to right shunt in this patient?
In this particular patient, for a paradoxically split.
Again, don't jump to that paradoxically split affair.
Signs of like a white pulse pressure and signs of.
White pulse pressure. Keep it simple, man. Yes. White pulse pressure is the most important physical sign here in this patient, most specific. Okay. Which you can elicit, which anybody can elicit, a first year postgraduate can elicit, a consultant can elicit, mother can feel the pulse, anybody can feel it. So that's a very hard sign. White pulse pressure, you know, precordial pulsations, apex down and out, shifted symptoms. These are all very clear features that you're dealing with a large left right shunt. Your PDA is restrictive because you have a continuous murmur.
Right.
I think I would just keep it at that. I wouldn't use any of these terms loosely. Okay. This normal systolic function doesn't belong here. Doesn't belong. You cannot tell. How can you tell? You cannot tell. You shouldn't be telling this on clinical examination. Not advisable. Okay. I think systolic function, all these things you should comment only when you have the tools to evaluate systolic function. So just giving you a little bit of a this is the problem with the bright student. They tend to be hyper precise. Don't try to be hyper precise. Right. You've got your tools, which are physical exam, history, X-ray, ECG. None of this will tell you about systolic function. Please do not venture into telling. It just shows you don't have the kind of experience because we know how often wrong we go when we try to predict function based on clinical evaluation. We go completely wrong. So it's very important. You're surprised all the time when we find systolic dysfunction. So remember that. It's very important. This patient will have abnormal systolic function when? Once you close the PDA. Once you close the PDA, this child will have afterload mismatch.
Yes.
Very high likelihood. So then you can have abnormal function. And then that also you can only identify by echocardiography. So it's very important to recognize this. But the features in PDA that tells you, unlike VST and AST, PDA tells you its hemodynamic significance by the pulse pressure. Very important to recognize that once you have a wide pulse pressure, your PDA is going to be operable. When you do echo, you'll find two signs that tells you operability apart from the usual LA, LV enlargement, et cetera, the gradient across the defect. Flow reversal in the descending thoracic aorta is highly consistent with operability. I have to wind up because I have another webinar. But I think that's excellent. Do you have any other data on this patient, X-ray, ECG?
Yes, sir. Yes, I have. So,
here you have some very good Q waves in V5, V6, which suggests
volume overload of left ventricle. Yes.
Very good. Okay.
Yes, sir.
And then there is some RVH. So this patient has congenital rubella from what you're describing, because bilateral cataracts with a large PDA definitely suggests congenital rubella. So you have to be very careful in evaluating this patient because you know what? You can have some of the continuous murmur can be because of your peripheral PS. So you have to be very sure that your evaluation is thorough. It's not just a PDA. It could be something else also. It could be bilateral branch PA stenosis. So be very careful. Okay, show the X-ray.
This is X-ray. Skygram PA view showing LV type cardiomegaly with LV type of apexa and prominent pulmonary artery segment.
Very prominent RPA is seen.
Very prominent RPA.
So you have to be careful and make sure there's no LP origin stenosis. So your echo has to be very thorough.
Yes, sir. And there is evidence of pulmonary plethora as well.
Yes.
Prominent end on vessels on both sides.
Yes.
Shall I go ahead or should I stop?
Yeah, no, that's fine. You've seen a large PDA. So I think you can close this with a device and you must have closed that at some point.
Yeah, we have closed it. Yes, sir.
Yeah. So that's fine. I mean, that's it's very nice. This whole thing, this presentation, I think it illustrated three different cases. It showed how you make an assessment, but you realize that there are no hard and fast rules. It's important to integrate entire clinical data, history, physical exam. Everything needs to be internally consistent, integrated with echo, and then you classify with the view to make a decision for the patient in terms of what you decide for the patient. I think we'll stop and thank you all for this.
One last question can I ask, sir?
Sure.
Second case VSD, there was a baseline desaturation of 91% aortic.
Correct. Yes.
What does it?
So that is during the cath. And I noticed that patient's resting saturations under other circumstances of 96%.
Yes.
So often when you make the patient lie down in the cath table, and this is a patient who might have been a little difficult to sedate, you end up sedating them and they end up with some degree of desaturation. Now, this patient did not have pulmonary venous desaturation, but that's because you only sample one pulmonary vein. You have to sample all four. So you may get some pulmonary venous desaturation because of that. Sometimes you can get a VST with significant aortic override, which will show some level of desaturation, but overall QPQS favors operability. So that also is possible. It's hard to tell in this patient what was responsible because we didn't see the echo images, whether there was override or not, the size of the VST. But these are the two possibilities.
Right. Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you all. Do we wind up?
Right, sir.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you so much. It was enlightening. Very interesting way to discuss as well. Thank you so much.
Yeah, I hope everybody benefited. Thank you so much.
So we are now towards concluding this wonderful program. I must say, this was an exciting program, which was quite different than the previous webinar series which we did. We had interesting case presentations, which definitely assisted the participants. I take this opportunity to thank you, sir, for your strong support. I take this opportunity to thank Dr. Mukund as well as Dr. Sudhakar Rao, who have been the pioneers for this academic support. Our platform is always available, sir, for this kind of academic initiatives in the times to come. Please let us know and we'll be happy to assist with this kind of platform. Thank you once again and take care, sir.
Okay. Take care. Thanks. Bye.